Thank you so much. It's great to be here, everyone. I hope everyone got plenty of lunch and is ready to talk about API security, which is my favorite topic. So right now, enterprises across the board are modernizing. We all went to reInvent. We heard modernization, the key word absolutely everyone's talking about. And this isn't just moving and migrating workloads from on-premises to AWS. This is also changing the way their applications are built. So we've gone from traditional web applications to APIs and microservices, serverless functions, everything you have there. And from databases, we've gone to data stores. There's so many different types of databases now that are being leveraged, data lakes, everything else that we see. And ultimately, as we look at the security and risk model that's associated with this, generally I like to look at this in two different ways. Outside of your organization, you have various threats that are targeting these applications. This is going to be through a combination of DDoS attacks, traditional web application attacks, any sort of automated threats that you might have, as well as some other types of attacks that are targeting things like supply chain vulnerabilities. We all lived through the Log4j, but everything else that we saw. Within your applications, you still have to deal with those traditional web application attacks and supply chain vulnerabilities. But then on your APIs, they have a whole different subset of attack vectors. And that's what we're going to be focusing on here today. As you move further back into your organization, your threat model changes from external attackers to more internal. You're looking for malicious, careless, and compromised users. Those are the major threats to your data stores. So with that, we like to say that the biggest areas of security, visibility, or the biggest areas of risk for organizations comes from modernization, and that is to your APIs and to your data. So this is a great stat that I pulled out from the Postman State of API Development Report for 2022. So 48% of API developers conceive, implement, test, and deliver an API to production within 1 week. This is an absolutely astounding pace of development. And what this tells me is that for the last 10 years, as we've been talking about DevOps, is that most organizations are doing it. They have CI/CD pipelines set up. They have everything that enables them as a business to basically go forth and to deploy very, very quickly and get workloads into production. So this is awesome. Congratulations. Give yourselves a round of applause if you are responsible for DevOps and for enabling your organizations to do this. The downside to this is that 44% of API developers also have less than 2 years of experience in developing APIs. And so as a security team, you have now this weird position that you're in where basically you have to secure the organization, but at the same time, your developers are really, really new to this. And so a lot of the challenges that we hear when we talk to CISOs is first and foremost a lack of visibility. This rapid pace of development basically makes it so your APIs are changing all the time. On top of that, we just announced and we saw in our bad bot report that business logic abuse is one of the biggest drivers and attack vectors for APIs in particular. So it's not just looking at the vulnerabilities and kind of the traditional types of attack vectors that you might see where they're trying to use a remote code execution or something along those lines. It's really going after the business logic of those APIs. And last but not least, some of the largest data breaches that happened in the past year specifically were a combination of API vulnerabilities resulting in sensitive data loss. So we asked our teams, what exactly constitutes a shadow API? How many shadow APIs are across organizations, and what is the prevalence of these? And what we mean by shadow API here is basically this is something that the security team has no visibility or insight into. This might exist in a developer's documentation, this might exist in the developer's head, but it's not something that security teams readily can see. And so ultimately what we found was that that exposure was actually about 45% of all API traffic was going to shadow APIs. Even for API development teams that have really robust API documentation, they swear that documentation is 100% accurate. I will tell you in 95% of the scenarios that I've talked to developers in there, that is not the case. There are all sorts of deprecated APIs and things that, well, they thought that those were gone and they marked them as deprecated, but guess what? They're actually still using them or someone is still using them and it's still exposed to the internet. And so this is part of the challenge with visibility. As I talk about business logic abuse before, one of the bigger challenges here is that attackers are getting very smart about targeting APIs. We had an airline in North America, they had a flight search API. That API was being scraped and it was leading to $500,000 per month in charges because they were paying for all of those queries. That is an astronomical sum. That got their attention very, very quickly that there was a problem. Similarly, we had a digital bank in North America. Their login API was also being targeted with ATO requests to a rate of 2 million attempts per hour. They had account takeover protection for their web applications. They did not realize that that mobile API that does the exact same purpose is the next thing that the attacker started to go and target. When we talk about account takeover related attacks, we find that 35% of all ATO attacks target authentication related endpoints. And so this really speaks to the problem that we see with APIs is that most organizations don't put enough attention to that. And then, of course, we have the business logic abuse itself. I won't go into detail on this one. We can talk about Bola attacks in greater detail later on. But effectively, what Bola attacks, it's the number one in the API top 10 from 2019, stands for broken object level authorization, as well in the API top 10 from 2023, which just came out last week. This is just a way for an attacker to use the business logic of the application and exploit weak authorization controls that exist. One of the biggest problems about this is that it actually passes all security checks that you might have in place. If you have a web application firewall or an API gateway deployed in your environment, guess what? That traffic looks clean and legitimate to all of those different services. The business context has a lot to do about whether or not this is or is not a valid example or use case. And so that's what makes it really challenging for you to be able to find. SAST and DAST scanners also can't find these vulnerabilities because they're related to business logic, not to an actual vulnerability that you might have. So the most common question I get when I talk to CISOs about API security is, how do I actually build a program? I don't want to deploy another tool. I just want to know how I can build this into my application security program as a whole. So that way it's something that's holistic. It's part of what we've already been building for the last 10 to 15 years. So the first step that I always say is first discover, classify, and inventory your APIs. You cannot protect what you don't know exists. And this is the first and foremost thing where you have to make sure that this is an automated process. The rate of change of APIs is so quick and it happens so fast that if you're not spending the time to automate this, then much like any other asset inventory you have in your environment, it's very quickly outdated. And please, for the love of God, do not ask your developers to go and manually document all of their APIs. They will hate you for it. The second one is then to go and identify implementation issues, common implementation issues like unauthenticated API endpoints that return sensitive data. It's a very obvious one, but some of the larger data breaches were doing exactly that. Those are pretty easy things to be able to identify, and being able to identify where those authentication and authorization headers are is really that first step. Next, we want to protect sensitive APIs. So we want to understand what is the data that's going across all those different API endpoints, and what are the controls that we can place for those. And the last but not least is to look for those behavioral anomalies. So those access patterns that just deviate from what your users are normally doing. So I'm going to go into detail on each one of these here real quick. So first and foremost, when you talk discovery, there are some very key requirements that you want to make sure that you meet across the board. For all of your APIs, you want to make sure you have headers, HTTP method, resource, path parameters, query string. This is a baseline. This is what you need to have to understand what the layout of the APIs are. You need to look at the request. In the request body, you'll have the request, the data types, the classification. This is very important because this tells you what your consumer API users are sending to you. And then ultimately, the response. The response is really one of the most important things. If you're looking to identify instances where sensitive data is going out the door, that's happening in the response. So if you're only looking at the request, you're missing a lot of the traffic. Similar to what we did on the request side, where we're looking at the actual response body, we want to know everything that's coming across in there. We want to do data types and classification of that data. And we want to know what the response codes, what is expected responses, what are the different ways that this API will respond and behave. With implementation issues, because we just went through the response and we just looked at the request for classification, we know what those authorization headers look like. We know how you're authenticating. Are you using a JOT? Are you using OAuth? How does that come across? Which header does it show up in? And being able to definitively say that no authentication header was identified or an authentication header was identified, this is a really good, easy way to do it. You map this with where sensitive data is. Now you have a very clear understanding of which API endpoints don't require authentication yet return sensitive data. I won't get into the details of mass assignment vulnerabilities, but this is an area where schema protection does give you the ability to protect against anyone going and changing that. The OWASP organization is renaming this to broken property level authorization. It's a worse name in my opinion, but we can talk about that offline. And last but not least, identifying those unnecessary data exposure vulnerabilities where APIs are returning data that they should not be. This is really one of the first things you want to look for. Within sensitive APIs, I like to look at it in really two different categories. So a lot of your traditional application attacks, things that are targeting CVEs or CVEs or different COTS vulnerabilities, those vulnerabilities, when you want to block those vulnerabilities, your mitigation technique is blocking. And I want to be very, very clear about it. It's blocking, it's not orchestration. It's not going and saying, well, we saw something bad, so send an alert over to some other system and make that other system block. No. These are one and done types of vulnerabilities. All it takes is one bad request to be able to block those. You need to block in real time. Now, that applies for those single requests that can basically go and exploit an API, but your stateful attacks, the attacks that are going to require tens or even thousands of requests in order for a successful vulnerability to be exploited, these are the ones where you have to be a little bit more nuanced about your mitigation strategies. And this is really the cool part for security teams, that they can work with the developers to figure out what makes sense for their applications. So we can talk about blocking, but we can also throw things like CAPTCHAs in some instances. We can do rate limiting. We can do tarpitting. We can do deception. Deception's a really fun one. It's returning fake data when you think that they're actually getting real data. Step-up authentication, quotas with your API gateways, even integrating into your third-party fraud and risk tools are great ways for you to be able to go and start to mitigate these vulnerabilities in a way that's appropriate for the business. Again, if you have a broken object-level authorization vulnerability, it's not going to be something that can typically be exploited with just one single request. It's going to take tens or thousands of requests. Credential stuffing attacks work in the exact same way. If you had one single account user get compromised, yes, that's a problem. But at the same time, it's not as a problem as 10,000 users getting exploited. And so from the API protection side, we like to look at business logic abuse in a couple of different ways. But first and foremost, we want to be able to go and discover all APIs, endpoints, and payloads, identify the susceptible parameters. The susceptible parameter for BOLA abuse is the ID field. It's the primary key. It's not actually something that you would normally think about as being the susceptible parameter, but it's the one key that you're using to look up all those different resources. And last but not least, after you've baselined that activity, you need to monitor for anomalous access patterns. This looks a lot like scraping attacks actually have in other instances. So a lot of the same algorithms and methods that you use are very similar across there. So real fast, quick plug, we released our 2023 Bad Bot Report. The reason why I'm talking about a bad bot report during an API security presentation is because the focal point for this bad bot report was how bad bots are now targeting APIs. And we see this specifically with business logic abuse as one of the biggest areas of focus. So please go download this report. It is excellent. It talks about some of these stats that I shared here in greater detail. Our threat research team is going to be unveiling quite a bit more in the coming weeks and months. And if you have any questions about anything application security or data security related, we have a booth right on over there. Unfortunately, I've got a really short session here, so I won't have time for questions, but I'm going to be over at the booth afterwards. So if you have any specific questions, please come ask me. Please come ask all of our staff that we have over there. They love talking about API security. It is one of our favorite topics. And with that, thank you all very much. I really, really appreciate your time today, and I hope you have a great rest of your show.